Hello, welcome to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm your host, Kendra Cook. The Boyertown Museum, located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, has dozens of vehicles on display, everything from horse-drawn carriages and wagons to motorized cars and trucks, and even to the self-powered bicycles. If you would like to contact the Boyertown Museum, you can do that several ways. You can give us a phone call at 610-367-2090. You can email us at mail@boyertownmuseum.org. And please feel free to visit our website at www.boyertownmuseum.org. The museum is open for visitors Tuesday through Sunday, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. We are closed Mondays and major holidays, including the one coming up in a few days, July 4th, and we'll be open again on July 5th and throughout the weekend. The current special exhibit at the museum is On Merit Alone, The Story of Acme, which will be on display until August 31st, which is also coincidentally our 48th annual Duryea Day Antique and Classic Car, Truck, and Motorcycle Show and Flea Market, which is held at Boyertown Community Park. And we hope we all see you there for that fun-filled, exciting day as well. We should have hundreds of cars and trucks on display. And if you have a car that you would like to show at Duryea Day, you can do that by filling out a registration form, which is available on our website. It's also available at the museum if you'd like to pick one up, or you can give us a call and we'll mail one to you. And if you don't have a car to display, we hope we see you there anyway as a spectator. There's plenty to do on Duryea Day. In conjunction with our special exhibit, I'm happy to announce we are going to be having a special one-night event on August 1st, that's a Thursday. At 6:30 p.m., we will be screening the award-winning documentary, The New Woman, Annie Londonderry Kupchovsky. And this is a documentary you can't see on YouTube, you can't see on TV. This is being shown at film festivals and private theaters across the country, and we are lucky enough to be able to screen it as well. The film is about Annie Londonderry, who was the first woman to travel around the world on a bicycle. And she did this in 1894. She set out on her journey. And she returned after 15 months, celebrated and also controversial figure. So this 30-minute film is about her. And immediately following the documentary, we're going to have the filmmaker herself, Jillian Willman, there to do a short presentation and Q&A with the audience. Tickets will be $7, and that price includes the film, the presentation, and refreshments. Since seating is limited, we do recommend you purchase your tickets in advance. Any tickets that are not sold in advance will be available first come, first serve at the door. And you can contact the museum again for more information and to purchase those tickets. Well, that's what I have to share on the museum front. And now about Wheels Along the Road. We are live the first Tuesday of every month at 9 p.m. And we do encourage our viewers at home to give us a call here at the studio. The number is 610-378-0426. And you'll especially want that number at the end of the program when we have the car quiz. And I'll give that number to you again later in case you didn't get it. And tonight I welcome regular commentator Dan Olsen. Welcome, Dan.
Thank you.
Now, unfortunately, Mike Yannessa is not with us tonight. He was feeling a bit under the weather, and I'm sure we'll see him next month. Mike, if you're watching, we hope you feel better soon. Our special guest this evening is Dick Schuster with the Heidelberg Heritage Society, which just a month ago rededicated the newly restored 1927 train station that sits in Wernersville. It's a beautiful building. You can see it from Route 422. And we're happy to have Dick here to tell us a little bit more about the station and its history. So welcome to the show.
Thank you, Kendra.
Thanks for being here.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, since Mike's not here, we're going to juggle our format a little bit, and we're actually going to start off with you, Dick, if you don't mind. We usually have Dan start off, but we're going to have our guest start us this evening. So go ahead, tell us more about this great building.
Well, I was going to give you a little background first. I am a member of the Heidelberg Heritage Society, which is in Wernersville. We maintain the Lurch Tavern, which is a 1797 structure that the Society purchased in the mid-70s, and then they restored that, and that now serves as our main headquarters. The mission of the Society is to preserve the history, the heritage, and the artifacts of the Heidelberg area. So back a number of years ago, Donald and Charlotte Moyer saw the potential for the restoration of the Wernersville passenger train station, and that station indeed did become available when Hoover Motors no longer had use for the facility. They were storing car parts in it since the time when they bought it in 1964 up until about 2001. So Charlotte and Donald and other members of the Society started a campaign and got the resources together to purchase the station in 2003. And it has been about a 10-year journey now until the project has been completed. I'm going to be showing some pictures of the station in a bit, but I wanted to just give you a couple of brief historical dates regarding the railroad. The railroad presence in Wernersville started as early as 1836 when the Lebanon Valley Railroad was incorporated. The first freight station was built in 1856, and the first passenger train went from Reading to Harrisburg in 1857, and a year later one was able to take the train from Philadelphia through all the way to Harrisburg. In its day, all of the passenger trains did make a stop at the Wernersville station, and there were about 26 trains a day that did make that stop. So the railroad did figure significantly in the numerous resorts that had begun to appear on the South Mountain in the mid-1800s. I think there were ultimately 9 resorts, and very wealthy people from Philadelphia and New York City would perhaps bring their families and stay for the summer in these resorts that featured health and restorative values. Though the original train station, which is on the first slide, this was a wooden structure, and this was built in 1881. And what happened was that the wealthy people coming through the area saw fit to have some pressure put on the Reading Company, and they decided to build a stone station, one of the few stone stations that existed between Philadelphia and Lebanon. So in 1927, the Wernersville train station was built, and the next slide, this shows the 1927 station when it was in use. At that time, there was a circular driveway that went up past the station, and it was set in a park-like setting, which now you would probably recognize as the vacant used car lot from the Hoover Motor Company.
Can I ask a question? That, like, where the photographer stand? Would that be 422?
Well, there? He was probably, like, at the Penn Warner Hotel, perhaps.
Okay.
But,
okay.
Yes, on 422.
All right. Sorry to interrupt.
Okay. So this is a picture of the 1927 dedication of the newly built stone station. And we use this picture as a guide to planning the ceremony for the rededication, which occurred recently. And we get to that slide, you'll probably see some similarities. But it is interesting to look at the way people were dressed at that time. Mm. The structure in the back with the cupola on top is the Wirtz Mill, and the iron structure that behind the speaker, that's the platform that covered the area between the tracks and where the train, you know, people would load up. Okay. Now, this slide that you're looking at is what the station looked like when the Society purchased it in 2003. It was not in the best of shape in terms of the windows, the woodwork. The stone structure, of course, was solid, and that was a real benefit to having that stone station. In the next one or two slides, this is a slide from the trackside. The canopy would have had wood and roofing material over it. You can actually see daylight coming through now because that structure is all missing. Now, this is one of the earlier shots. The society volunteers were involved throughout this project, initially with cleaning out the leftover stuff that was left by Hoover Motor Company, just cleaning out the basement, the attic. And then subsequently, the volunteers got involved in doing the projects that we could do. And this one shows the iron structure. There's scaffolding set up, and we had volunteers that scraped the rust off the metal and started applying paint. And this is another one of our volunteers. He's up on a scaffolding plank on top of that structure, and he's working on that curved attic window. The attic had four windows, one in each compass direction, and each center window opened on that. And we were able to restore the north one, which is the one you're looking at, and the trackside one. The east and west one had to be replaced. They apparently got the weather a little harder. Another one of our volunteers, we were fortunate enough to have Spring Valley Millwork. It's kind of a neighbor in Sinking Spring, and they initially donated the four windows in the main room of the train station. And this is one of our volunteers that are helping to install that window. The one on the opposite side is already installed. And these are folks that were working on that arched window. That was a massive arched window that had to be taken out, and then again, our Spring Valley neighbors at the millwork company, they made up windows that would fit perfectly into that opening, and that's what's happening here. These are the fellows that are measuring for the installation, and then the actual new window being installed. Now again, this is a picture of the station somewhat in progress. We were working on that door section at the time. And that is an example of the completed work. Now that was the front door, the parking lot side door, and that was a new construction, but it is similar to the trackside door, and that one we were able to rehab ourselves. Now these are interior shots. This is kind of what the station looked like when I got involved in the project in 2008. You can see the wood lath in the corner of the building. There had been a leak in each corner of the main room, and the plaster was destroyed. The wood lath either had rotted or fallen off, and much of the woodwork, including the bench you can see, is kind of warped and distorted. And again, this is a different corner, but you can see the condition of the station. And again, another example of that. This was the station master's area. There was a bay window that projected out onto the trackside platform. The station master would have sat at a desk there and would have been able to look left and right or east and west up and down the track to see the approaching train so that he knew when to make the announcements. This was the trackside door. This was the one that we ended up rehabbing. Now, the interior didn't look too bad. It was the exterior that needed the most work. This is the exterior of the bay window that we were just looking at from the inside. That was just completely boarded up. Now, there were a couple of projects that the society got into, and I probably should take a minute to go into that at this point. Right after the station was purchased in 2003, the slate roof was in bad condition. So the society did have the slate roof repaired with a very similar roof that would have matched the original. And that was handled totally by the society with our own funds. The second project, the heating system was a coal-fired steam boiler. And as you could probably picture, the boiler and every pipe was covered in a thick layer of asbestos. So we did get a grant that covered the asbestos abatement, and the company came in, took it all out, and then they also repaired the areas of the floor on the first floor that had been rotted through, again, because of those roof leaks that were coming into the building. So that was the second major project. What we're looking at now is the third one. This was in 2010. We had our general contractor, A.H. Moyer, in Myerstown, again funded with grant money we received from PennDOT, and they provided us with underground electric, water, and sewer, also a new heating system, which was then operational, and also a functional bathroom. So that was quite a milestone in terms of stabilizing the building once we had heat in it, and the volunteers could go down to work, and we had water to clean up, and you know, we had facilities. It made a big difference in the efficiency of the cleanup program. This is just a shot. We're actually looking up the trench. The trench begins just about near the driveway that goes into the pizza place that's next door, Feliciano's Pizza. That's where the electric came from, and the sewer and water came from very much that same location. So they had to dig quite a long trench over toward the building, and then it was all buried, and it's now you don't even see it. You don't even see electric lines going in.
You know, I'd wondered about that because I drive by it, and I was wondering how it was feeding electric.
Yeah, we had probably a 10-gauge wire coming in when I got involved, and that was the total electric that was coming into the building. So now we have quite an ample service. Yeah. This is a picture of the steam boiler that's down the basement, and one top section there has been broken away. But we did decide to leave it in place. It is kind of an interesting piece. People that have never seen a steam boiler, certainly something that old. So that is in existence in the cellar. This is another shot in the cellar. The couple sump pumps standing around, none of which worked, and of course there were a couple inches of water in the floor, mainly because they didn't work. But the metal cabinet that's standing pretty much just to the left of center of the picture was actually a container that had water pipes that circulated in the bottom. And we determined that they probably put a block of ice in that, so that they had ice water that went to the fountain, which will be in a later picture. But I thought that was very interesting. In 1927, we had ice water going to the fountain.
Nice.
This is our new heating system. That's a oil-fired hot air, so there's ductwork that runs down through the entire length of the crawl space in the building from the very small, full-size part of the cellar. This was the original electric service panel for the station. This was what was actually our electric flow through there when I got involved in this. And of course, the utility phase of the project was the installation of a new load center, which will be in the next slide. And that's now our power comes through that. And we have certainly upgraded the safety and you know, stability of the station. That's the original 1927 water fountain that was in the building when we purchased it. It wasn't in place, but it was in the building. And that's the one that would have been fed with the ice water. In the late 2011, we began the last project, and that was the project that was aimed at making the building fit for occupancy. So what had happened is the demolition people came in and they took down every square inch of plaster on the walls and the ceilings, And that's what you're looking at now. You're in the far side of the main room, and you're looking actually all the way through to the bathroom. This was the pile of insulation that was awaiting installation in the ceiling. There was no insulation in the building, so of course it was expensive to heat once we had that heating system put in. When the plastering began, the trucks pulled up and they unloaded 7 tons of plaster material, and that's the pile of stuff that you're looking at. And there was an additional 7 or 7.5 tons of blue board. And that actually, some of the blue board is installed in the walls in the picture that you're looking at. And then they went and put 2 finish coats of plaster over that. And this is a picture of it a little bit more advanced. This probably has some of the plaster coat on because the pile of plaster is diminished. And also the lighter colored woodwork, the wainscoting, that was replacement woodwork that had to be added because of the areas that were deteriorated again from the roof leaks. Another part of this recent project was the removal and reinstallation of all of the concrete sidewalk and curbing that went around the building. It was really in quite a deteriorated condition. Now, this is the beginning of that demolition work. And this is the finished product. There's one square at the end there that's waiting the concrete. The rest of it has all been done at this point. Now we're getting into some pictures of the interior of the station, the way it looks now. After the construction project wrapped up and moved out, we were able to start moving in some of the stuff that we had either stored or were purchasing to furnish the station. And the roll top desk came from the artifact bank in Reading. We purchased that there. The safe actually came from the Wernersville VFW, but it's a pretty much of a good replica of the one that would have been in the station.
It looks perfect.
This was the reconstructed bay window area that you might remember from the earlier slides. The desk was made up, the new windows were put in. The chair that you're looking at there was actually the chair that was used by William Brock, who was our last station master in 1958. And some of the other artifacts on the desk were from donations from his family. And that's a somewhat of a dark picture, but that's from the main room, again, looking into the ticketmaster's office or the station master's office. The sign that you're looking at now has a generic name of South Mountain Resorts on it, but back in the day that the station was in operation, each of the resorts that existed on the mountain would have had a sign with their name on it. So Grandview, Walters Park, South Mountain Manor, each would have had a sign, and they were positioned along that long metal overhang structure. So just like today, if you go to Disney World or take that kind of a vacation, you just, you know, leave the airport or the train station and you go out and you queue up at the sign of the resort that you're going to, and then their vehicle would pick the people up and take them up to the resort. Initially, the resort sent horse and carriage down, and then, of course, in later years, they switched to automobiles for the conveyance of the passenger. Wow. That's a view looking at the baggage window. And again, just like when you're traveling today, you would have brought your baggage with you into the station. You hand it into the baggage man. He would mark it, tag it, and you wouldn't touch it again. He would put it on the train for you. They'd unload it when they got to the Wernersville station, and a separate vehicle would convey your baggage up to the resort for you, so you wouldn't have to lift it. This is one of 2 of the original baggage carts that the Society owns, and these would have been used at the freight station, which is now the pizza shop next door. But this is the one that we have luggage and suitcases loaded on. This is the one we generally pull in the Memorial Day parade or for special events. This is the one we bring out on the avenue. We really didn't have any idea what the women's waiting room looked like. Each bathroom, men and women's, had an ante room or a sitting room. The women's had a chair rail, so we were assuming that they would have had some furniture similar to what we did purchase. And we picked up, you know, a floor lamp, end table, and a mirror just to kind of replicate what we think that area would have looked like. I don't have a picture of the men's room, but that would have had just two wooden benches. The men didn't rate quite as well.
You didn't get nice cushions.
But the men did have a spittoon.
Well, of course.
This was the a photo of the rededication. Those are four of the people that spent a lot of time in the pursuit of the restoration of the station, and we all got to share in holding and cutting the ribbon. And that dedication was on June 8th of this year. Now, the basket was very similar to one of the ones that was in the original photograph with the flowers in it. And this is a group of our members. Most of them are dressed up in costume that would have been appropriate to the period of time. This was the speaker's platform for the dedication ceremony. And our master ceremonies of the day was Judith Cranus. And that is a picture of the finished product looking at it from the track side. So at this point, the station does not have regular hours, but we're more than happy to open it up to show people. If you check on our website, heidelbergheritage.org, it'll have contact information, and either myself or someone else would be more than happy to come down and meet folks and give you a tour. We do anticipate there will be some open houses throughout the year, but the really haven't determined that yet. We'll have a meeting coming up real soon and try to come up with a regular schedule that hopefully the public can access the building. I think
you guys did a lot of work. One of the first photos didn't look too bad from the outside, but you can tell there was a lot to tackle.
And that was the fortunate part, the fact that it was a stone building. We started with at least a sound structure, even though there was a lot of interior work that had to be done. We really had a leg up that way.
Yeah. Well, it's beautiful. It turned out great, I think. And the other building is great, too. The tavern is nice. I've been in there as well, so.
Good.
Encourage people at home to visit you guys. Okay, well, with that, we're about halfway, so it's time for a message from BCTV.
You're watching Wheels Along the Road on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other related stories, go to www.bctv.org. Program underwriting is a valuable source of revenue for bctv.org. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
Welcome back to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. If you're just joining us, I'm your host, Kendra Cook, and I'm now going to turn the show over to Dan Olsen, who is going to tell us what he knows this month.
What do I know? Okay, first of all, if you were watching the show last month, we were talking about Bucron tires, and there was a caller who called the TV station and was talking about, I believe his father sold tires to the Amish people. And that created a bit of discussion after the show. And we were wondering, the Amish just have steel tires and such. But then I was asking around and we figured, maybe if they use the pneumatic tires, they'd be using these old Bucrons because they're more of a natural material than the synthetic things. And the Amish, since they like the traditional, we figured that's where they were going. And then somebody else mentioned they might use the old tires for belting or something in their machinery. And we don't know. We were just speculating there. And we thought that the caller had a very interesting thing that he called in about. Well, the next day I go home and I go onto the into my emails, and I got a email from my niece. She lives in Colorado, and there's a picture there. And if you could show the picture, there it is. That's an Amish wagon in Colorado with pneumatic tires on. Now, I don't know. I doubt if they're Bucron, but I just thought that was so interesting. And I was also happy that, you know, one of my favorite nieces, if you're watching right now, sent me this picture. And she lives out there in Colorado, but I understand it was another niece was staying out there for a short time, and she's the one who actually took the picture. So there you go, a little bit of follow-up from last month. So that was that. Okay, now to get it back to the regular subject here. Back in the day, I think I'm old enough now to say back in the day, okay? But I'm going way back further than that. You look at cars from maybe 100 years ago, and the colors of the cars, a lot of times, if you had a certain type of car, certain model, it was a certain color. It's like, you know, a 1913 such and such touring car was a Brewster green in color, okay? Well, the Roadster of the same car, that might have been Battleship gray, for instance. And I guess for extra cost, you could have a different color. But in most of the cars back then, that's how you got them. They were a particular color. And through the years, there was other colors into the 30s and 40s and up to probably into the 70s even. You'd have spring colors also for to boost sales up. They'd have a certain color for cars and such. Well, I came across some stuff, and it's certain cars were certain colors, and some of them have kind of an interesting story, so I'm going to tell you about them. And the first one is called the Big Brown Luverne, if you could show the picture of that. And that's a Big Brown Luverne. That's a black and white picture, but take a wild guess what color that was. It was brown. Initially, they were called Onyx Brown, but then they changed it to Luverne Brown. And Luvernes were from Luverne, Minnesota. They only made about 300 cars, trucks, fire trucks, hearses, and, you know, not a huge amount of cars. But that's one of them from 1921, I believe that is. And anyway, that's the Big Brown Luverne. And actually, it's not a 21 because they didn't make the brown ones that long. But anyway, that's just one of those cars. It was a marketing thing. They called it a Big Brown car, and that was it. Now, the next one is a little newer. This is 1923 Jordan Blue Boy. You can probably guess where the blue came from. And Jordans were quite popular cars. You maybe have heard of the Jordan Playboy, and that was pretty well known through advertising and stuff. Anyway, the Blue Boy was made from 1923 to 1929. Again, that's a 1923 model. And off of one of their advertisements, I have a bit of a quote here. It says, built for those happy people who bought a Jordan Playboy for their honeymoon, but now want a little more room for the friends they take for an afternoon of golf. The wheelbase has been lengthened for lowness. Cushions hug the floor. The top fits like a swanky sport hat. And all is slender, except the tires. They are fat. I didn't understand that part about the tires, but that was just advertising back in 1923. The next picture here is a 1932, I'm sorry for the smallness of it, but that's 1932 Plymouth PB Sports Roadster. With the rumble seat, which that has, cost $595 in 1932. Great car. a little over 2,000 of them were made. Now, for $40 more, you could have the Collegiate Special. And what that did, that just gave you a choice of colors. You could talk to the factory, or, well, I guess through the dealer, and say, okay, my school colors were this and this, and they would paint your car those two school colors. And I thought that was neat. They were trying for the youth market back then, you know, back in 1932. This one in particular is kind of an orange and pale yellow, and it's the owners of it painted it that way because the wife of the owner went to a school, and that was their school colors. My school colors were red and blue, and I'm thinking they might not really look that great on a car back then.
So anyway.
So that was the 1932 Plymouth PB Sports Roadster Collegiate Special. So that was kind of an interesting little thing there. Okay, the next picture here. I was at a car show a few years ago up in New York, Norwich, New York. And there was a gentleman there who had a Packard, just like you see here. It was gold colored. And, you know, I'm looking at it, and he had some signage there. He comes over, he starts talking to me about it. He says, this is one of two that are known to exist in the Golden Anniversary Packard. All these Packards for 1949 were called Golden Anniversary Packard, but they made like 2,000 of them with the actual gold color, one for each Packard dealer through the country. The guy talking to me, he says that his car was originally from Pennsylvania. I knew of this picture here. This is a picture of the Packard dealer in Boyertown. And I got all excited. I'm thinking, wow, wouldn't that be cool if this guy's Packard came from Boyertown, and it's that one we see in that photograph right there. But it wasn't. His was originally from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Anyway, this car here, as I say, is 1949 Packard, and it's in Heffledger's Service Garage, which was the name of the Packard dealer in Boyertown. There's a parking lot there right now, if anybody's familiar with Boyertown. Where Bouse's drugstore used to be, you kind of go around the corner, there's a small parking lot, which was for the drugstore. That's where the Packard dealer was. And I've kind of stood there on the sidewalk and kind of imagined what the dealer would look like. You know, fairly small. We're probably looking at the whole showroom right there. And
yeah, that's not a big parking lot.
No.
Really?
No, it isn't. No. But I figure back in 1949, showrooms were rather small, and they had you know, room for one car, maybe two cars in offices. And I'm thinking if they had a repair facility, that might have been at a different location. And so that's that. Now, this gentleman in New York said there was one, his was one of two known. I went online, I found out there's actually 16 of those gold-painted cars that were known now. There was a problem with that paint. The pigment, the gold pigment on it, faded really quick, got chalky. I have a quote here. It says, sunlight cuts through the clear lacquer and eats up much faster than opaque paint. A paint made of bronze powder and clear lacquer, which that gold paint was, would have deteriorated as the clear wore off, leaving a dull gold or flat effect. The only way to prevent this was to wax the car regularly and to keep it in a garage as much as possible. Of course, all paint in those days, 1949, got chalky and weathered if not protected by wax. But a paint with a lot of clear would be much worse. That reminds me, when I was a kid, we had a neighbor who had about a 1950 Ford Woody station wagon. And I guess originally it was maroon, but I remember it was this faded, purplish, bad-looking car, and they didn't take care of it in the wood. On that, they didn't put the coats of varnish on. That was all splintery. It looked pretty bad. So anyway, 1949 Golden Anniversary Packard right there. And again, we had that picture hanging up in the museum. I had Kendra hunt it down and email it to me.
so I could show to our fine viewers on the TV show here. If you show the next picture, we're going to get a little bit newer here. Again, sorry for the small picture there. That's a judge, or the judge, by Pontiac. That's 1969 when they were first introduced. They came in any color you wanted as long as it was carousel red. That's a carousel red car. Midway through the model year, they opened it up to several other colors, but that's the carousel red. Most of the ones you see are that color if you go to a car show. Once in a while, you'll see one that's different color, and it's kind of makes you stop in your tracks. They also, I think it might have been the next year, they had another thing called Orbit Orange, which was kind of a funny faded pumpkin orange color, but that was kind of a unique color too. But anyway, that carousel red was made just for that GT, or the judge there. So, next picture, please. This is 1972, and we have, in that picture, left to right, we have a Pinot, a Maverick, and then a Mustang. And they had a special package called the Sprint Package, offered only in 1992, special red, white, and blue paint with matching interior. And they patriotically acknowledged the 1972 Olympics. The U.S. cars had a stylized U.S. flag made. It was a decal on the rear quarter panel. If it was a Canadian car, they kind of looked the same, but they had a Canadian flag, a stylized Canadian flag on the quarter panel there. Okay, now for the last thing. Here's the thing that kind of made me do this whole topic today. But you remember back in 1970, I think a year earlier and a year after that, the Plymouths and Dodges had a bunch of really weird colors. Well, the colors maybe were weird, but the names were even weirder. For instance, a Plymouth had Inviolet, which was like a purple color. The Dodge, it was called Plum Crazy. Everybody can picture a Plum Crazy car, that purple color. There was a Vitamin C, was a Plymouth. If you had a Dodge, it was Go Man Go. And there's the Hemi Orange, which was Dodge, Toured, Plymouth. Limelight, which was the Plymouth. And Sublime, which was Dodge. Most of these colors were real bright and stuff. And viewers, you're probably sitting there thinking about others. I know there was a Citroen Yellow, which I thought was a great name of a color. And there's Sassy Grass Green. And there's a whole bunch of them. But, you know, they're pretty well known. You see a lot of cars there. But in 1969, in the middle of the year, Ford introduced the Maverick. Okay, we showed a Maverick a moment ago. But when they introduced it, they had weird colors too. But before I show you any of these, you have to think what the word Maverick means. Dictionary says, an independent individual who does not go along with a group or party. Okay, so they had a bunch of colors. They had something called Hullabaloo, which was a light blue, about the color of my shirt. That's why I'm not wearing plaid tonight. They had a Last Stand Custard, which was a bright yellow. Actually, that was in 1970. That came out. Counter Revolutionary Red, which was a red color. Now, if you got a Ford, a regular Ford, you could have the same colors, but it was called red. But the Maverick, being it was a Maverick thing, was counter-revolutionary red. Well, you also have to remember this country back in 69 and 70, what was going on? You know, everything against the government, against this. There was a very unpopular conflict going on overseas. So all that. They actually had another color called Bring 'em Back Olive, or Bring 'em Back Alive. And, you know, every time I see that, I kind of like, wow, how could they do that? But that was one of their colors. I have a paint chip chart here for Ford, and there it is right there, the dark ivy green iridescent for all the other Fords. For the Maverick was called Bring 'em Back Olive. And I, you know, there's another one, Home on the Orange. In other words, home on the range, you know, just stuck another letter in there. That was a vermilion color. But the best one, and the one I like, it seems like everybody likes this, was the anti-established mint, M-I-N-T. And we got a picture of one, and if you could show that, please. There you go. And that's, it's nothing really exciting. It's like a metallic green, but there's your Maverick there. And it was very interesting, clever advertising there, goodbye old paint. And they were introducing all these wild new paints for the Ford Maverick. So that's kind of it. There's actually more colors here, but it was really interesting when I came across all these Maverick colors. And then the more I delved into all these special colors, there's all sorts of interesting stories in that segment of the automotive thing. So that's it.
I also love anti-establishment.
Yes.
It's my favorite.
Yes.
I like that. All right, and we're going to keep it in your court here, Dan, and go to car quiz. And give me a second here, and I'll start that up. And, of course, the phone number here at the studio is 610-378-0426, and I think...
Okay, if you
we're
could
good.
Show the first picture, there we go. And, boy, this is kind of a special car here. So if you can call up, if you know what that is, if you know what model, little special model that is, boy, you get four bonus points. And I saw that at a show a few years ago. It was in the rain. So That car, I'm trying to think, they had actually three different models, special models, so if you say any one of those three, you're going to get your four bonus points or three, whatever it is. But the different ones were because of the size of the engine, you could have a six-cylinder or two different sizes of V8 engines on that. And I'll give you a hint, the model, the light on the roof is a hint. Okay.
Yeah, I wonder who used this.
Oh, I don't know. And also the red lights next to the headlights, that was another thing. The badge on the door, that was all kind of a hint there. So, okay, we have a home viewer. Yes, what is that?
I believe it's a Studebaker about a 1962. Does that sound right?
Oh, you are right on. Yeah, look, a 62 Studebaker what?
I can't tell you what
okay.
the special model was.
It was kind of a special thing. It was called a Marshall.
Oh, okay.
And if it was a city Marshall, it would have a six-cylinder. If it was a patrol Marshall, it would have a 259 cubic inch V8. And a pursuit Marshall was a 289 size engine. And so you think the bigger engine goes with the more power you want. So that was kind
well,
of...
Well, yes.
Okay.
The six-cylinder was a nice engine for the size of that car.
Right.
And it was easy to work on.
Yep. Okay.
The eight was kind of crammed in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, if you wanted to pursue somebody, you got the V8 then.
Oh, I understand that.
Yep. Okay.
Okay.
Well, thanks
thank
for
you.
Calling.
Thank you.
All right. We'll see what else comes up.
Okay. Yeah, that was taking a Studebaker meet out in York a few years ago in the rain. But okay, next picture, please. There you go. That's kind of an oddball. The person who owns that, I believe, lives somewhere in this area because I've seen that car several times over the last few years. That's taken at the McCungee Truck Show. I just noticed that.
And well, it must I like have been, the look of that.
It must have been a rainy day there, too. I see a lot of mud. So that must have been the year they had the half track pulling trucks
oh,
out of the mud. So
that was a rainy year, for sure.
But what's unique about that, you look at the back end of it, is a pickup truck. The front end of it is automobile sheet metal. So... You know what this is, Dick?
No, I don't.
There you go. Okay. Oh, we got a home viewer. Go ahead.
Yeah, Dave again. It's a Chevrolet. It's an odd one, you know, not too many of them. I think it probably was something from, like, maybe down Australia way. And I would call out a 1951 or a 52 Chevrolet.
It's a 52 Chevrolet Ute, or utility. It's Ute. They
yes.
made them in Australia, as you said.
Uh-huh, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So yeah, it was something you didn't see in this country.
No, no. That's right. That's right-hand drive on that thing.
Uh-huh, okay.
I went online, they had a picture of one of these that was all hot rodded up, and I'm thinking, boy, it's ruined a nice vehicle there.
That's
my case, so. Okay, well, thanks for calling in again.
All right.
It's two for two.
Let's see if we can do it again.
Okay. So there he is. Dave just got our Studebaker and our Chevy. And, you know, I was concerned about this car because I know a lot of the GM cars down in Australia were called Holdens, but they used the Chevrolet name for this vehicle back in 52. It was in 53 they started with the Holden. Okay, next picture, please.
Well, that's different.
It is different. It's black.
That's different from the last one.
I saw this... at the Concours show in Bethlehem. That's where that was.
Okay.
A number of years ago. The car came equipped with a 210 cubic inch straight six engine, 160 horsepower. Thing cost $4,039 back in, you'll have to guess the year, which was a lot of money back then, of course. Produced over 12,000 of them. Now they had a special one of them that they made within that year that had a bubble canopy on it that was run on the roads, and they were they did that and got 172 miles an hour, a special race thing on the roads. And since they did 172 on regular public roads, they called it the world's fastest production car. Now, that car there would never go 172 miles an hour. So, it's English, but I can see part of the steering wheel on the left side, so I guess it's was imported to the U.S. way back in that year.
When 4,000 was a lot of
money. When it was $4,039. If there's a viewer out there, I can tell you to wait. Maybe that'll sway your thinking, but it weighed 2,920 pounds. So anyway, I'm gonna tell you what it is because we're short on time, and that's a 1953 Jaguar XE120 Roadster. They made a little over 7,000 Roadsters. They made about 2,600 coupes, and then they made about 1,700 drophead coupes, which had the convertible roof. So this wasn't really a convertible. It was a Roadster without the wind-up windows and that whole deal. So that's it for a thing. We squeezed three of them in this month, folks. So that's better than we've been doing the last few months. So,
good job.
Thank you.
And I have to also mention, go back to your car colors.
Oh.
You can't sneak in a mention of the Pontiac Judge without also mentioning who was in the commercials for the Judge, for the GTO.
Oh, well, I'll let you mention that.
It's Paul Revere and the Raiders,
mm-hmm.
who Dan and I talk about probably rather frequently, strangely enough.
Yes.
Great commercial.
Yes.
It always makes me think of that. Well, that is the end of another edition of Wheels Along the Road. And I want to thank Dan and Dick for being here tonight. Thank you, guys. And hopefully we'll have Mike back with us next week.
Yes.
And until then, happy motoring to you all. We'll see you in August.